My name is Jill Tisbury, and in today's tutorial I thought we'd have a little bit of an experiment with some brush-o watercolour inks. I already have an image which I've done. If you look here, you can see there's the reference shot which we took at Tropical Birdland in Leicestershire. Great place to go if you want some really good reference shots. And this particular piece I thought would work really well today because A, it's cute, you've got one parrot feeding the other, but parrots are really quite vibrant and they're very lively, as you'll find out if you actually go to Bird World. So they're always flying around, they're quite dynamic, and so I wanted a finished piece that kind of captured that and showed the splashes of colour that parrots actually make when they fly around. So this is my reference image, I'm just going to put that to the side. If you saw issue 2 of Paint and Draw, then you might have seen a little review of this thing. So this is a Cutalola dots pen, and it's a really, really easy thing to use. So take the lid off. You've got a button here. When you press it, the thing starts to go backwards and forwards. When you double press it, you end up with a pen. Drives you mad, I have to say, if you spend hours actually doing the dots things on this, as I did. There we go, just turn that off for a minute. But that's exactly what I did to create this image. So I am working on watercolour paper here because we're going to use watercolour inks. This is 300 DSM or 140 pound watercolour paper, so it's reasonably thick, and I've used this frog tape to tape it down to try and keep it quite flat. Don't worry if it does cockle as you work on it, watercolour paper sometimes does depending on how wet you get it, but you can always, you know, re-wet the back of it and then flatten it out once you've finished. So a little bit of preparation then. Before I actually start with the inks, you can probably see here very slight difference in colour, but this is masking fluid. So right on this edge of this wingtip here, down his beak here, there's a couple of flecks on his claws, on his foot there, and then of course the whites of the eyes. I've whitened those out, or masked those out, I should say. And here on this branch that they're sitting on, there's a few flecks of masking fluid here as well. Now, the reason I've used masking fluid on this is because I want that to be a crisp wipe when I finish. That's the only way I'm going to get that. The other thing that you can use is this, which is a brush-o wax resist stick. Doesn't have to be brush-o, as long as you've got a clear wax crayon of some description, then you can use it as a resist. You could probably even use a white wax crayon if you want to. So what this will do, because this is hot press paper, by the way, so it doesn't have much of a grain. If you use something that had a grain in it, you'd get a much more bitty sort of result with this. But this wax crayon, if I use this as a resist on the scaly parts of this, like where I've got the parrot's feet, then I can just, you can't really see this very well, but what that's doing is laying down a little bit of wax, and I'm just putting tiny flecks in here. And what that'll do is resist the ink as we paint that on. So you will actually end up with a sort of mottled effect that stops the paint going through to the paper. So I'll just do that on these claws and on this beak area as well. If I bring this in, you can probably see, let's put that by the side. Whereas this has got a definite white line on it, or a real definite highlight, this hasn't. It's quite grainy. Now I've made this a little bit less diffuse than this because I want to see the detail in the eye, and I didn't quite get that in focus. I obviously got his beak in focus, but I still want a bit of a grain on that rather than highlights. So I'm just going to use this to put a couple of highlights in there, just down the side. There we go. I think that's probably it for the parrots. There might just be a little bit of a grain that I'm going to put on the bark. So we'll just do that. And then we are good to go with our brusho. So there we go. A little bit round the edge here. And it'll just add a little bit of interest, a bit of texture. Just around that edge bit where that bark piece is. We'll see what that ends up looking like. Okay, so I have prepped my piece. This ink that's in this Cutalola Dots pen, by the way, is permanent ink, so it's not going to run. You can do this with any permanent ink pen. Someone asked me recently about using a biro. I would steer clear of a biro. It is lovely to work with, but if you want to put a wash on top of it, what you'll find is lots of particular makes of biros tend to bleach out to this sort of purpley colour ink. So make sure you've got a permanent pen if you want to do a pen drawing beforehand, before you put wash on it, and then it's not going to run. Right, so I'm almost ready to start with my brusho ink. Before I do that, I'm just going to use this. This is, if you've used pastel mat, you probably recognise it. It's crystal paper and it comes in between pastel mat sheets in the pad. But I find it useful for this because what I want to do is mask out the big, massive areas. So I actually want to mask out the parrots. So all I've done is I took a sheet, you can probably see just there, dropped it on here. The reason I've drawn those different, I just traced those areas from my drawing, is that at a different time, I might want to mask out just this bit of the beak, so I can then go in and cut those out. But for now, I've just cut out around the edge. Oh, stuck that on there. Always sticks when you don't want it to stick. There we go. So I've cut around the edge of the main subjects. I'm just going to put that down there with a bit of tape, and the same here with a bit of tape. Let's move that out of the way. I've kept the bits that I've cut away because there'll be a time when I want to mask out that area of background, but what we're going to do next is actually work on that background, so I'll take that away. I also kept that little piece which is over here somewhere, because there might be a time when I want to mask that out, but for now that is actually a bit of the background that we see through the back of the bird. Secure that in place. Fabulous. So that's masked out, and the reason it's masked out will become clear when we have a look at the brusho. So let's have a look at these brusho inks then. So, brusho inks. There's two boxes that I've got here. The first one is a sort of pack of 12 that I had for a while, had a little play with, and it wasn't until I decided to do the pen and wash that I've really got back into it. So these colours, as it says on there, they are brilliant. They're very intense, very vibrant colours. And in the 12 pack, you get the things like ultramarine, you get turquoise, scarlet and lemon, things like that. But what brusho have also done recently is added to the range. So you now got things like rose red. I wouldn't say that it's any less intense, but probably slightly muted, maybe the wrong word. But they're very vibrant, but they're beautiful colours. So we're going to have a little look at what they are like. So this was a little experiment that I did just to get back into this. And you can see what happens, a bit like watercolour, and when you salt with watercolour, if you've been using watercolour before, watercolour washes, then you're perhaps used to putting salt crystals on to give you this mottled effect. Brusho will do a similar thing. You can probably see here as well, we talked about that wax resist. This is a slightly more rough surface than the one I've got here, but this gives you that effect when you put this wax resist on. So I've got my palette. I've just put a piece of paper, a piece of kitchen towel on here just to protect this for the moment, because you can see from my hands already that it does go everywhere. So have some baby wipes on hand as well to wipe your hands. This is sandstone. This is what it looks like. You can see, really difficult actually to tell what that colour is going to be until you put some water with it. So I'm only going to put a little bit in there. I'll leave that there for a second. What's this? Yellow ochre. So this is the background that I'm going to do here. And I got a moss green. And before I actually go into, those two look very, very similar. So you'd be forgiven for thinking they were exactly the same colour. So I haven't got very much here, but I'm going to put some water onto this now. So this is just ordinary water. I find these bottles quite useful. And as soon as I drop water onto this, you can see the colour starts to come out. And I've got a number 5 sable brush here, just a watercolour brush. Make sure that's cleaned. It's useful to have some kitchen towel around when you do this. Just going to mix this together. I've got a bit of paper here. So if this is the first time that you've used Brusho inks, it's really useful to have a sheet of watercolour paper and just have a look at what that colour is, what that colour looks like. So this is the moss green that we talked about. And you can see this is really quite dark. Just clean that brush off. This is the yellow ochre. Huge difference between the two. They looked exactly the same when we sprinkled them on. And this is the sandstone. So those are my three colours that I think I want to mix together to use for this background. So I'm going to start out by wetting the background and then sprinkling the colours on to get that mottled effect. So we're going to go ahead and do that. I'll leave this over there to dry because I might use that paper a little bit later on just to test some more colours. Now I'm going to keep that palette. I don't want to waste that because obviously you can use this in the same way that you use watercolour in, you know, normal watercolour basically. Just get rid of some of the dust that might be on there. And I think I mentioned earlier on that this dots pen is permanent. This isn't going to run. Still got a little bit of colour left in here, but that's fine. And all I'm doing is I'm wetting the background. I'm being careful to sort of stay a little bit away from the edge, as close as I want to go. You can probably see it's getting a little bit darker where I'm actually going up to the edge, and it's going to creep a little bit anyway. That's fine. The reason I put this mask down is because I'm going to use this as a sprinkle on top, then it's likely to go everywhere, and I don't really want to get that on the parrots. So this is really quick when you actually get going. So make sure that's nice and wet. Okay, let's get rid of that. So we said we've got yellow ochre, we've got sandstone, and we've got moss green. Okay, so for this, rather than dipping into my palette, I'm going to dip into my yellow ochre. I'm just going to bash that on the side. Now hopefully you can see that if I hold that against a white bit. I haven't got very much there at the moment because I want to be quite controlled. As you probably know, I'm a detailed person, as you can see from this. So this is actually as wild and loose as I usually get. But I find this quite invigorating, really, to actually do something like this. Because it's very different from how I normally work. And I find I get carried away with this. Now it might not be looking much at the moment, but I'm going to go back into my yellow ochre. You can probably just see it's starting to bloom in some places, but I think this might be drying out in the studio. So we've got a trick for that. It's absolutely fine. Now you can probably see, if you look at those, I'll just get some more. There's reds, there's all sorts, because this powder is made up of different pigments to get the terracotta earlier on. It's yellow ochre, isn't it, that I'm using here. So I'm going to drop some on here. Be careful you don't put too much. I'm just going to pop the lid on because I've been known to spill that everywhere. So this thing here is a little spray. You can get spray bottles. I just find these useful for if I'm travelling. So if this isn't doing what you want it to do, this paper started to dry out, then you can use this spray. Now, I'm going to do this from a fair height. I'm going to move my pigments out of the way first. Otherwise, I'm going to get sprayed pigments. So from quite a height, I'm just going to spray and let that fall onto here. Make sure that that's, you see why I've put the, you probably see that's starting to come to life. And whilst that's there, I'm going to take some of the moss green. And drop that in there as well. Drop a little bit of the sandstone in. Up at the top. I'll go back in with my spray. You see why I put kitchen towel down, because it can be really messy. Now, if you want this to go in a certain direction, I want this to go away from the parrots, you can start to let that run as well. Create yourself some sort of almost leaf-like look. So this is quite abstract. Needs a bit of courage to allow yourself to just let it freeform. And again, if you find that it's not doing quite what you want it to do, sprinkle a little bit more. Now, if you've got something that's actually going a bit too far, then you can use your, I'll just get rid of this for a second. You can use your kitchen towel just to mute that down a little bit. I think we need a bit more down here. I'm going to do some of that moss green down here. So just adjust as you go. I want this to be a reasonably dark background. I find I get carried away with this after a while. Some dark elements in there to suggest more shadows. Dark darken it up in the corners a little bit. So the higher you drop the brush over from, the further it's going to spread, and the lower you go, obviously you're going to get concentrated areas. So where I wanted these concentrated bits of shadow, I've gone a little bit lower. Oops, wrong way around. And then where I want it lighter, I'm just going to drop it from a little bit higher. Oh. So I think we'll have a little bit more of the sandstone there. I'm just going to drop a little bit of lemon. So this is one of those pots that I've poked the hole in the top of, which is, I'm just going to lighten it up around there, and you can see you can sprinkle straight on. I'm just going to tip that. That's a little bit more controlled in the background. And then I'm going to do a similar thing down here. So I'll just move this up a little bit so you can see it. So you might have noticed then that I have taken the crystal paper off and I've just put this yellow frog tape on. I took the green off because I wanted to try and stretch it out a little bit more, which I've done. Yellow frog tape is extremely low tack frog tape, so it didn't really stick that well, so it might come up as we go. But I've taken the crystal paper off. There's a couple of runs which I'm not that worried about, but there's bits in the middle and there's some of these edges that I just want to tidy up a little bit. So you might recall that we had our test palette of colours when we were actually looking at them to begin with. So I can use these just like normal watercolour, and I can just blend some of these colours in just because I want a crisp edge around this bit. So where we didn't quite go so close up in some of the areas, I'm just using clean water and a tiny bit of paint just to blend that out. I think those are fine. It's probably, I'll just move that a little bit. It's probably down here which most of the work needs to be done. So I'm just using the sandstone to go right to the edge. And again, the more water you use, obviously, the less vibrant this is going to be, more transparent it's going to be. Sometimes you can just pick up the colour that's there just by having a wet brush. So I'm just going to the edge, and the crisper it is, the more the main image is actually going to stand out when you start to do the work on that. The more diffuse this background is, so you're going to get a better depth of field when you actually start working on the piece. So I think I'm nearly there. I'm just going to blend that. I used a hairdryer, I don't know if I said, to just dry this. Just blend that out. So you may find it handy to just keep a hairdryer on call. A bit more colour into that. Darken that a little bit as well. See, you get carried away with this. You start doing one thing and it turns into entirely another thing. So if you are one of those artists that needs to know what it's going to look like by the time you've finished, you might find this is a useful exercise to do because it really frees you up a little bit, makes you a little bit looser. So I love this. This is a really Those are only three colours there. That was the yellow ochre, the moss green and the sandstone that we used. But if you look here, you can see there's hints of red, there's hints of blue, that sort of turquoise. So all those pigments go to make up that one colour. And especially at the top, when you start to look here, there's some sort of terracotta-ish colours, some purpley colours. I love that. I think that looks like a really nice diffused jungle type background now. I filled in this bit here, this little bit. Actually, it needs a little bit darkening there, I think. Just so that we've got that background bit. And we'll notice that we've got a few runs here. I'm really not that worried about those because it's fairly loose composition anyway. So the next bit to do is start on the parrots. So I'm going to do the head of the parrots now, both of the parrots actually. This is probably the most detailed bit of it. And I know that a lot of people like to use brusho as a really loose and impressionistic look, but you can use it lots of different ways. So for this part of it, for the beak, for the ruffle around the head, the red bit, and just around the eye, I'm going to get a little bit detailed, and the rest of it I'm going to go looser. And that's the beauty of brusho. You can use it however you want. So you can use it like watercolour, or you can sprinkle it as we've done before. So I've changed my palette slightly. I cleaned it so that I don't get mixed up with colours. I've got a grey, which is this one here. Just going to move these off to the side as I tell you what I've got. I've got a rose red. Now, that is actually quite a deep rose red, so we're going to use less water with that and try and get something that's really quite light for around the parrot's eye. I've got an orange and I've got a scarlet. So those are my four colours that are here. I've just renewed my water and I'm using a number two Kalinske Sable brush. So this is the bit that we're going to do here, the beak for both of the parrots. Remember, I masked that off, so we should have a nice white bit here. And then this little rough sort of skin around the beak, around the eye, and then the red ruff, this bit here. I'm going to start with the beak, and I want to use, I'm going to move this water over here so I'm not taking it over my painting. I'm going to start with, you can see this is like a purpley grey, which is actually quite nice. So I'm going to start with quite a puddle of water there rather than mix it into my ink, because then I can control it. And you can see the more water I put in here, the lighter grey this is becoming. So again, a bit like watercolour, I guess. You start with a light colour and you can darken it up. And he's got some really quite light bits. Now, you might remember also on here that we put some wax resist. You see that? So if I just do a light wash over the top of all of it, because I'm not too worried about the white bits, because we did actually put that wax resist, and you can see where we dotted that in really gently. We ended up with these little pieces where, you know, we're not going to get any paint whatsoever. So if I want to go a bit darker, just drop a bit more of that pigment into here. And just around this bit, we've already done it with the dots pen anyway to get a little bit of texture in here. But this is a little bit darker, just to give him some form. There's a few dark bits here. And again, I've now got a sort of greeny grey. I'm not too worried about the colours on this. The reason I've got a greeny grey is because obviously within that grey, there are lots of different pigments. But that's fine. It just picks up a little bit of what's in the background. And I'm just going to put the detail down here. Now, I'm actually going to make that whole lot darker on that edge, just to enhance the form a little bit. And this is, because this is all damp, I've just picked up a little bit of pigment on the end of my brush. I just want to let that run and do its stuff. I have to say, these are quite cheeky birds. This grape that he's got here, he actually nicked from my bag of food that I was feeding him. Now, you can see this wax resist is really doing its stuff now. The darker we go, the more contrast we're going to get there. Okay, so it's quite quick. And this bit is quite dark anyway, so I'm just going to use what's on my brush. And what's on my brush looks like it's a bit more purple than grey. Again, I'm not that worried. I think I want to darken this little bit up, just around here. So again, I've got some pure pigment on my brush. Let's just get rid of that. And I am going to add that water just to blend it out a little bit. I don't know why I whisper when I start to do this bit, but I do, because maybe I think I'm distracting myself. Okay. Oh yeah, that looks quite cool. So I'm happy with that little bit. I'm just going to do this while I've got the grey. It seems to have found a terracotta speck of pigment, which is actually quite nice, because around here he has got a little bit of red reflection. So let's go up here. So this again is the masking fluid. I think there was a little spike of masking fluid there as well, so I'm just going to put that on as a wash over the top. Got a bit of a shadow there, so let's just do that. And this bottom one more at it. So this is quite a quick medium to use. It's great for kids as well, because they love to watch it, especially when you do this kind of thing and use it like a salt shaker, because that's something different, I think, to what they've used before. But it's very messy, which probably appeals to children as well. Well, it can be messy, if you're like me, as you can see, which is why I suggested the baby wipes earlier on. Okay, let's just drag some of that out. This is next to this highlight. This is going to create that contrast. I think he's got quite a dark bit down here as well. Now, if you put too much on and you think that that is definitely going to be too dark for you, just clean off your brush and just pick back up, and you'll, especially if you've got something like this, which is a quite nice long round brush, it'll pick up any excess that you don't want. I also got a little bit round here, so before I go there, just on that edge, he's got a dark bit. Now I'm going to use pure water there just to make that bloom out a little bit. And that'll be dry by the time we come to do the green bit. Now rather than have that solid edge, I'm just going to use this cotton bud. Just to pick up some of that edge. So you try all sorts of things to add, you know, some subtle texture in here. You could rag it with a piece of kitchen towel, if you wanted to. Again, just to pick up some of that excess and add a little bit of texture. I think I am happy. Oh, I'm never happy, am I, with things like that? See, this has picked up a little terracotta pigment piece here. And I quite like this, because I like this sort of specks of colour that are appearing everywhere. And because this is really vibrant ink, it tends not to be dull, where you can actually dull things down when you're trying to mix particular colours. So I'm not mixing them together at the moment, I'm just using these as they are. You see, I can get some really nice veining sort of cracks to this beak, because it's quite scratched. I think that bit needs to just be a little bit darker. Now, my trouble here is that I'll keep going and I'll spoil it. So I think that looks fine as it is. You can always go in with more colour and darken it up afterwards. But I'm going to leave that as it is. I'm going to move on to the rose red, which is around here on his tongue. And then we'll gradually get a little bit darker and do the ruff on the top. So I'm just going to clean my brush. Okay, let's have a look then. So, that's my cleaning water, that's not what I want. I've got two waters, by the way, just to let you know. That's my cleaning water to clean my brush out, and this is the water that I'm trying to keep. Often I go the other way around, but I'm trying to keep clean so that I can use that in my palette. That's why I put that one over there, to make sure I don't muddy these colours. Now, I'm just going to wipe this grey out of the centre well. There we go. I'll just dry that out. Typical, eh? That's not what I wanted to do. And now I've got red water. So this is this rose red that we've talked about. It's quite dark, isn't it? Quite a dark colour. Beautiful colour, but there we go. Just want to wipe that for a minute. The other thing that you can do if you're not so good at keeping your water clean, like I am there, is use one of these. I use these in all sorts of painting, especially with my airbrush painting. And this is great because you can just squirt some water in there. So I always have that on hand if I need to. So that's quite transparent. And if you're not sure how that's going to come out on your painting, remember we did this right at the beginning, then just use it on here. And I'm quite happy with that. I think that's quite a light colour to begin with. Remember, because it's exactly the same as watercolour, we can just build up our layers. Now this isn't quite dry on the beak, so the beak's blending into this, but I'm okay with that there. I'm just going to dry that bit there, because there is some shading that we need to put into that bit. So just around his eye. I don't want that to bleed in there, so I am just going to drop that in. Now I really want the dots to do the work of the detail, and I'm just leaving a little bit of the paper for some of the highlights as well. So that'll do for this bit, just a little bit further up there, I think. And he's also got some bits here, so I think that would bleed into that a little bit. That's fine. And let's do this chap down here. He's got a little pink tongue. And again, once this is dry, you can then come and add any other bits that you want to. Like this, for instance, here has got some texture on it. You can do that with watercolour pencil if you really want to. You can let this blend in, which is starting to do a little bit. I want to try and use brusho for most of this work, so I am going to let that just touch the edge so that it bleeds in, because this is not quite dry. It bleeds in and gives me a little bit of detail there. I'm going to add some pink into this because he's got, I think it's a reflection from this chap. A little bit of a reflection there. Now the other thing I'm going to do, because I forgot to do this earlier on, is I'm just going to take my masking fluid really quickly. And it's a highlight that I forgot to put in. So this is my masking fluid. Any masking fluid's fine. And I've got an old brush here that's a bit past its best. Masking fluid is not kind to brushes at all. So you don't want your best brushes for this. And this here, you just see this, is the grape. And I want that to be a really vibrant red. Red grape, but usually when you see red or something like that or something really vibrant in a painting, it's going to be the first thing that your eye goes to. So I really want this to stand out because it takes you to the middle of the drawing and then allows you to travel over the rest of the drawing. So I'm just going to put that in there and let that dry while I do the other bit. So I don't want that. I want that to be a really, really clear highlight in that grape. I'm just going to get rid of that masking fluid. Although this is an old brush, I still want to use it again for masking fluid. So there we go, let's get rid of that. Okay, let's clean my brush. So we put the pink in, excuse me. I think he's got some, we'll do that dark later. I think what we'll do now is this bit. This is a really bright bit. I'm going to just twist this a little bit. Although we've got this pink in here, I think that I want to add some scarlet and some orange. So I'm going to keep that there rather than clean that. I'm going to take some orange. Oh, look at that. That is really, really bright. Okay, well, we like that a lot. And we're going to do this little ruff that they have just above the beak. Now I'm going to go in with this first. Doesn't look like the right colour, but when you look at the reference image, what you'll see, and I'm dotting this rather than painting in, what you'll see is that you've got some lighter colours underneath, and then on top of it, it's really scarlet, so I'm going to do this as a base, to be honest. That's a nice contrast against that purpley grey. The other thing I should say actually about this tropical birdland is that the parrots actually fly free, and they've all got cages, and they go in there at night. They put themselves to bed, a bit like chickens. Well, a bit like our chickens do anyway. And then they decide when they're going to get up, when they're actually going to interact with the public, and if they don't want to interact, they go away. And they let you know as well. Oh dear, that's a bit vibrant, isn't it? So again, no problem. Just clean your brush off. And you can just mute that down a tiny bit. This is the scarlet red. So he does have some scarlet bits here. Yeah, so they're very cheeky but very sweet. And they usually won't leave you alone either, once they know you've got these grapes and other bits. So it was a fun day out, really. Oh, that's looking cool. So as we drop this colour in, you can see you start to build up that texture. It's really quite nice. And again, if you find that parts of it have dried, don't forget you've still got your spray. Just be careful with that, though. If you do decide to spray on that bit, you might come over here as well. So it might just be...